But I'm kind of going to back up here a little bit. Revelation 21, God does something amazing. If you always remember all the way back to Genesis 1:1, what's it say there? In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And after he created that, he created us. And then we did something incredibly stupid. Let's admit it. And we allowed curse to come into this world, and we allowed someone to win, at that time known as the devil. Here in Revelation 21, though, it starts off with a new earth and a new heaven being created again. I debated even talking about this morning. As I've been preparing this sermon, it's been kind of a good sermon. It's a good message to talk about. We don't talk about Revelation 21 a whole lot in the church, do we? We focus a lot on other stuff, but Revelation 21, we step back and we avoid. And I'm wondering if sometimes the devil's wanting us to do that. As I left here last night, I got home and Abby says, well, how'd the sermon go? And I go, eh. And I started realizing why it felt that way to me. Because someone lost who had won before, and that's the devil. We should be glad and glorious to read Revelation 21 here. And let's be honest, there's a lot of stuff here in 21 that I don't have the answers to, you don't have the answers to, and none of us will have the answers until the day we're setting in that new kingdom that God is establishing for us. So let's approach this with reverence as much as we can, but also recognize that there's some beauty here that God is bestowing upon us. He's showing us the finish line and what he's prepared for us. I want to go back to John, actually chapter 13 here. And this is kind of an interesting passage here. If you remember back in John 13, that's where John is recording the Last Supper and stuff. And there's this discussion that comes up here. And then there's Simon Peter. I'm going to pick up in 13:36 here. And I'm going to read here about five verses. It says, Simon Peter said to him, that's Jesus, Lord, where are you going? Jesus answered, where I go, you cannot follow me now, but you will follow later. Peter said to him, Lord, why can I not follow you now? I will lay down my life for you. Jesus answered, will you lay down your life for me? Truly, truly, I say to you, the rooster will not crow until you deny me three times. Do not let your heart be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many dwelling places. If it were not so, I would not have told you, for I go to prepare a place for you. If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. That's what we're talking about today. We're talking about that place that Jesus is talking to Peter here and saying, Simon Peter, I'm going to go prepare a place for you. And we're going to read about that specifically today in Revelation 21. So let's pray and get into this message. Father, thank you for being a gracious God, one who has shown us the scriptures here. Lord, one who is providing the answers, Lord. And there's some things here that we won't comprehend, and Lord, we may never comprehend, but we are anxiously awaiting your new earth and your new kingdom to be established, Lord, that this new earth will not have the curse of this earth. And it won't have the temples that we have here, Lord, but we will have you and your Son to worship for all eternity, all day, forever. Father, be with us, guide our hearts. And Lord, also let us recognize the warnings in this chapter for those who will not be able to be there. And if there's anybody here who is living in that warning, Lord, I ask that they cry out to you and call upon your Son's name and seek him. For we want everybody to be a member of this kingdom to come. It's in your Son's name we pray, with Jesus Christ. Amen. Like I said, we're going to be in Revelation 21. And I'll be honest, a lot of times we don't preach about a new earth and a new kingdom coming. We talk about the heaven and all this, but I'll be honest, there's a part of there where I'll be honest, last night I didn't sleep much at all. I didn't sleep because this was bugging me, and I'm going, the devil's really good at telling us that, you know what, the earth we have here is the earth you're only going to know. But God's removing that earth and making a new earth. That's a scary thought. Everything you know today will not be in this kingdom. Why? Because that's the better way. And it's been talked about elsewhere in Scripture. Actually, if you go to 2 Peter chapter 3, Peter talks about this too. And it's made very clear that this kingdom is going to be established. There at the end of his epistle, in 2 Peter 3, picking up in verse 10, says, "But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, in which the heavens will pass away with the roar, and the elements will be destroyed with intense heat, and the earth and its works will be burnt up." That's us here right now, this earth. "Since all these things will be destroyed in this way, what sort of people ought you to be in holy conduct and goodness, looking for and hastening the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be destroyed by burning and the elements will melt with intense heat? But according to his promise, we are looking for a new heaven and a new earth in which righteousness dwells." That whole righteousness thing is a huge part here, and that dwelling part. We're going to dive into that dwelling part a little bit. So let's go ahead, jump back to Revelation 21, and I want us to read all of 21 and actually into 22. But we're going to take it chunk by chunk here for a little bit. And then John, here's his account in Revelation 21:1. It says, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth passed away, and there is no longer any sea." John makes it very clear the earth that we know today is going to be gone, and the sea and everything is going to be a done way, and then there's going to be a new earth and a new heaven come. And then here in verse 2, he talks about the new Jerusalem. "And I saw the holy city, new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, made ready as a bride adorned for her husband." How many here have been to a wedding? Hopefully, if you've been married, you've been to a wedding. I've never been to a wedding where there's an ugly bride. They're always gorgeous. And here, this bride that's coming out of heaven that John's trying to describe is so gorgeous that words can't even fathom. And I think that's why John stops a little short there. And then verse 3, "And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is among men, and he will dwell among them, and they shall be his people, and God himself will be among them." There's a story about, I don't know if you guys know the name John Wesley. He started the Wesley movement, the religious movement. There's a story about him having a dream and him standing at the gates of hell, and he knocked and on the door and said, "Are there any Roman Catholics here?" And the answer was yes, many. "Are there any Church of England people here?" "Yes, there are many," said the voice behind the door. He says, "Are there any Protestants here?" "Yes, there are many." And he asks, "Are there any Wesleyans here?" And the door said, "Yes, there are many." John Wesley, being a little disappointed, then went up the stairs to heaven and knocked on the door there and says, "Well, are there any Wesleyans here?" And the answer behind that door says, "I don't know who you're talking about. The only people here are the sons and daughters of God." That's the kingdom that this is talking about in Revelation 21. This verse here in 3, where it says, "I heard a loud voice from the throne," that is the last time that phrase will be said. This is the 20th time. All the way back in the very beginning in chapter 4 is the first time this voice from the throne has spoken out. And then this is the last time the voice of the throne will speak out that we're reading here in Revelation. And it proclaims this statement saying, "Behold, the tabernacle of God is among men, and he will dwell among them, and they shall be his people, and God himself will be among them." All the way since the very beginning, what has God wanted to do? This is a question for you guys. He's always wanted to have a relationship with us, right? He's always wanted to fellowship with us. He's always wanted to dwell with us. You look back in Genesis 1:1, what does God do with Adam and Eve prior to him kicking them out of the garden? He walks with them. He dwells with them. He has a relationship with them. He wants to be part of their life. And that's what God's reinstituting here in 21. It's very interesting when you start looking at this, that word dwell, where he says he dwells with him. Some of us may think, well, dwell, that means like, okay, I go over to my friend's house, I sit down, and I dwell in his presence. That's not what this word means. It's actually only used 5 times in scriptures. 1 time it's used in John and 4 times in Revelation. And this word dwell is the idea of an all-encompassing aspect of laying over the top of. You guys remember the tabernacle where they would lay the garments of stuff over the tabernacle and God would dwell among it? The whole presence of the tabernacle would have the presence of God in it. The idea here is also kind of similar where it talks about, you remember the scripture that talks about a hen covering her chicks and them coming under her and they're dwelling within her presence? That's the idea here of this dwelling. It's the idea of being so intimate with the person you are with that there is no misunderstanding of who you are in a relationship to who they are. You guys get that? That's what God wants from us. Our God is not a God of put him in a box and set him over here. Our God is a God where he wants to be with us and walk side by side with us, experience our joys along with our pains, and also answer those pains with joy answers. That's what God has always desired. The problem is we choose something different in the first creation. Where here, God is instituting something better. And what does he do because of that? Let's keep on going here in verse 4. And he will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there will no longer be any death. There will no longer be any mourning or pain or crying. The first things have passed away. It'd be amazing if those could disappear right now. But let's be honest, they can't. It's the world we live in. But this world that John's trying to describe here, there's none of that. And then verse 5. And he who sits on the throne said, "Behold, I am making all things new." And he said, "Write, for these words are faithful and true." He's saying these are going to come about. Don't just look at what's being written here on the page in your book, if you have it this morning, as something that might take place. No, these are going to take place. Here he is saying, these words are faithful and true. I am faithful and true, and thus these will be carried out. What Jesus spoke about in John 13, it's going to happen. It's going to carry about. And then in verse 6, it says, "Then he said to me, 'It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give to the one who thirsts from the springs of life of water without cost.'" There's a beautiful statement there in the fact that he says, "It is done." If you have been paying attention at all through Revelation, there's been a couple times where it's been said, "It is done, it is done." The last time that I can remember where it was saying, "It is done," was the pouring out of the bowls, where God is pouring out his wrath upon the earth and actually doing away with all the evil and the destruction of mankind. But here, the "it is done" is the reinstitution of God's kingdom. It's where we get to go and dwell in God's glory. God says, "It is done. It is finished. I'm the Alpha and Omega. I'm the beginning and the end. I have taken you from here all the way to here, and I have been in between, and I will forever be that way with you." And thus it is done. But then there's a warning here in verse 8. But in verse 7, he gives a little different statement. "He who overcomes will inherit these things, and I will be his God, and he will be my son." That's the beauty. That's the good part. But then right after that, he gives the warning. "But for the cowardly and unbeliever and abominable and murderers and immoral persons and sorcerers and idlers and all liars, their part will be in the lake that burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death." That part has already taken place. Paul spoke about that last week. That's at the very end of chapter 20, where it talks about death and Hades being thrown into this lake. that has already all been removed. So the only thing left, if those people in that warning has already all been removed, then the only people that are left are the ones who are not of that group, which are the, verse 6, 7 there, those that have overcome and inherited these things, and that are the sons and daughters of God. Those are the only people that are going to be allowed into this new earth and this new kingdom. That's the harsh reality of the situation. I think that's also the reality that Satan doesn't want people to really recognize too. I have a hard time going to funerals and stuff, especially people who I know hadn't made a profession of faith, were like, oh, they're in heaven, I'll get to see them there someday. Let's be really honest, we don't know. There's going to be people in heaven that we think are supposed to be there that are not going to be there. There's people in heaven that we think should be there that aren't going to be there, and that shouldn't be there that are. But really it boils down to the fact of, what have you personally done with Christ? All of it is a personal aspect. You can't speak for the person beside you today. You can only speak for yourself. Verse 9. Then one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls of the seven last plagues came and spoke with me, saying, come here and I will show you the bride, the wife of the Lamb. This is a beautiful aspect here. You got one of the angels coming up to John and say, hey, I got something to show you. I want to show you this bride. Keep in mind, this was the same angel who had some of the plagues. And I bet John's probably sitting back going, I don't know if I want to come with you, but you're an angel. I'm going to trust you. And you got something beautiful here you want to show me. I'll go with you. And so he does. There in verse 10. And this is where we see the new Jerusalem and some of it being done. And he carried me away. This angel carried John's away in the spirit to a great and high mountain and showed me the holy city, the Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, having the glory of God. Her brilliance was like a very costly stone, as a stone of clear jasper. It is a beautiful city. We're going to actually read about it here in a second. And I think this next portion here in Revelation, John does his extreme best with the human words he's got to explain something that I think is indescribable. He is describing the dwelling place of God and Jesus in their full glory and their full righteousness. And the words he's using here, we'll sit back and go, wait, that doesn't make sense. Let's just realize what it is. They're trying to describe something that is unfathomable. Let's get into it here. If you're a geologist, I'm sorry, I'm going to mispronounce some of these words, but we're going to work through it. And I want you to pay attention also to how many times the number 12 is used in here, or the multiple of 12. There's some interesting aspects to that. It had a great and high wall with 12 gates, and at the gates 12 angels, and the names were written on them, which are the names of the 12 tribes of the son of Israel. There were three gates on the east, three gates on the north, three gates on the south, and three gates on the west. And the wall of the city had 12 foundation stones, and on them were the names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. There's an interesting thing right there. If you actually go back, a lot of people have contributed going, wait a second, why is there the 12 names of the sons of Israel and then the 12 names of the apostles? That is where you're seeing the old covenant and the new covenant coming together in this one structure that God has designed. There's some beautiful aspect there and some theological stuff that is way beyond my understanding. Picking up there in verse 15. The one who spoke with me, this is the angel, had the golden measuring rod to measure the city and its gates and its walls. The city is laid out as a square, and its length is as great as its width. And he measured the city with rods. And as your scripture says 1,200 stadia, mine here says 1,500 miles, its length and its width and its height. And he measured its walls, 144 cubits, or 72 yards, according to the human measurement, which is also an angelic measurement. The material of the walls was jasper, and the city was pure gold like clear glass. The foundation stones of the city walls were adorned with every kind of precious stone. The first foundation stone was jasper, the second sapphire, the third carnelian, the fourth emerald, the fifth sardix, the sixth sardis, the seventh crimson. As I said, I'm not a geologist here. Chrysolite, the eighth beryllium, the ninth topaz, the tenth chrysopras, the 11th jadeite, and the 12th amethyst. I am butchering those, and I know that much. But I'll be honest, they're beautiful. If you actually look up those stones, those stones cover the whole entire compass of a rainbow. They are beautiful from the darkest shade is reds to the lightest shades in the world. It is a beautiful experience here. And that's what the city is made of. It's made of these precious stones. And then he talks about the gate. And the 12 gates were 12 pearls. Biggest pearl I've ever seen is about the size of a quarter. Can you imagine a pearl the size of a gate? Each one of these gates was a single pearl. Massive. And the streets of the city were pure gold like transparent glass. This is how do you describe this? I was thinking about this also, and it was kind of the bride aspect, sticking with that. And some of you ladies with your wedding rings, I don't even know how to describe your little wedding rings you carry. With all the stones and how they shimmer in the light and just reflecting, how would I go away and with words describe that? And yet here, John is having to describe the bride of Christ, this new Jerusalem. This is a massive city. How long was it from side to side? 1,500 miles. Give you guys a perspective from where we are here to basically Los Angeles, California. That is 1,500 miles away. So square that out. That is just the base. Here's the other thing. It goes up 1,500 miles. A little bit of perspective here. The International Space Station orbits the Earth at 250 miles. Our satellites, the highest satellites we have are about 1,500 miles up. And those are the GPS ones that kind of tell you where you are in the world. And this is where the brain of Chris kicked in again. And he did some calculations. Let's imagine this is the Earth. Now keep in mind, this is the Earth as we know it. This is Chris using calculations from the Earth here. This new Earth may not be the size of the Earth we currently have. It may be bigger, it may be smaller, I have no clue. But this is using the Earth we have today and I'm trying to put this new Jerusalem on this Earth we have, if I can find it here. And some of you have probably seen this before. But that would be it right there in relationship to the Earth that we live on at this moment. That is massive. People go, well, how is God going to fit everybody in there that's a Christian? I think he's got room. Let's be honest. Give you a little perspective. I don't know. Maybe some of you in the very front row can see that little itty bitty dot right there in the center. That is actually the size of New York City in relationship to this city. It is massive and huge. Hopefully they have very good elevators. That's a lot of stairs. But it is a marvelous city, one that words, and as we know it today, can't describe. And it's gorgeous. Let's keep on going here. Verse 22 picks up with an interesting statement. It says, I saw no temple in it, for the Lord God, the Almighty, and the Lamb are its temple. If you look at every city on the earth today, most likely there is a place of worship, right? Every city, if you actually go back and you look at America, one of the ways they defined a city or a town was it had a post office and it had a church. But here in this city, there is no church. There's no temple to go and worship in. There is only God and the Lamb, for they are the temple. Verse 23 talks about a little bit more. And the city had no need of the sun or of the moon to shine on it. Keep in mind, the earth as we know it, the stars of what we know today are all being changed and done away with. And there's no sun. There's no moon. Why? The glory of God was illuminating it, and its lamp is the Lamb. I don't know how this is going to be. Honestly, I have no clue, but there is no sun. There's only God and Jesus. They're illuminating everything. And that illumination is going to be so bright, I bet there's going to be no shadows. God's presence is going to be all dwelling and membering among us. It's going to be wrapping us around. The nations will walk by its lights, and the kings of the earth will bring their glory into it. In the daytime, for there will be no night there, its gates will never be closed. Gates back then were designed to be closed at night to protect the city. Here you have a city who has no nights, whose glory is so empowering that it gives light to everything surrounding it, and so there's no need to close these gates. And they will bring the glory and the honor of the nations into it. And then here's the warning again at the very end of 21 in verse 27. And nothing unclean and no one who practices abominations and lying shall ever, does it say so sometimes? No, shall never. That's another harsh reality of the world to come. Come into it. But only those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. That's the end of 21. You guys ready for 22? Let's read the first five verses of it and work through it. Then he, this is the angel again, this is the angel that has been taken with John, showed me a river of the water of life, clear as crystal, coming from the throne of God and of the Lamb. This is hard to imagine, and actually this verse should be carried up to probably the first part of verse 2 there. Says, in the middle of the city, or in the middle of its streets. We don't have any idea how this city's laid out. John doesn't give us any idea, but apparently there's this river that's flowing through this city, apparently in the middle of the street, and it's pouring forth from God and his son is pouring forth. When you stop and you think about everything that lives on the world today, what does it require? A place to live, light, and water. God here has instituted those three things. He's made a place for everything to live. He and his son are the light, and he and his son are the living water being poured out. And then here in the verse 2, it talks about this tree that we've heard before all the way back in Genesis. On either side of the river was the tree of life, bearing 12 kinds of fruit, yielding its fruit every month, and the leaves of the trees were for the healing of the nation. Okay, this part kind of twists my brain a little bit. You got this river here, and it says that the tree of life is on both sides of the river. I have no idea what that means. Some people suspect that maybe this is like a grove, a tree grove on both sides. Or maybe the tree literally comes down and splits with the river flowing through underneath of it. I don't have any clue. But it's beautiful. Let's admit it for what it is. And every month it provides what? Fruit. Wait a second here. We don't have a moon anymore. We don't have months anymore. So that means continually this is providing fruit. And then there at the very end, this is a very puzzling part that I don't have the answer for, but it's kind of complex and beautiful in itself. And it says the leaves of the trees were for the healing of the nations. Wait a second here. We're now in a new kingdom, a new earth, a new heaven, where there's not this curse. So there's no pain, there's no sorrow, there's no suffering. So why would we have healing? I don't think this is healing in the sense of healing, like from a physical aspect. This is healing as in a sense of sustaining aspect, where you are being driven and pushed forward and being nurtured and guided by God in your daily walk, your daily healing, your daily presence with him. And that's being done for the nations. Verse 3, there will no longer be any curses, and the throne of God and the Lamb will be in it, and his bondservants will serve him. They will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads. It's very obvious that God and the Lamb are the ones that are going to be served. And his bondservants here, that's his church. Those that worship and desire him are serving him. This is not the idea of, serving God is like giving him a meal, but serving and giving praise and glory and worship to God, just like we did before you got to hear me speak today. And you're probably going, let's go back to that part. Yeah, let's go back to that part. Let's praise and give glory to God. Let's sing and praise God for who he is and for what he has done. But what about these people? They will have the name on their forehead. That'll be the forefront of their mind, their forefront thought of every day that they live in this new earth. We've heard this forefront head aspect here. If you go all the way back with the beast and stuff, and what happened to them? They've been removed. In the end, though, you'll have to make a choice mentally and physically to either serve God or serve the devil. This group has been removed. So the only ones left here are those that have on the forefront of their mind to serve God. Revelations 21 and part of 22 here has seven things that will completely be done away with. And we've hit on them already, but I want you to realize them again before we go too far. These are things that are going to be completely gone. There'll be no seas. I'm sorry if you're a sailman. You're not going to have any seas to sail on. But I'm willing to bet there's going to be some beautiful rivers. That's in Revelation 21:1. There'll be no sorrow. Hallelujah, for sure. No crying. Well, if there's no sorrow, there's definitely no crying. There's no pain. Verse 4 of 21. The curse is gone that we know of today that causes our body to physically decay and causes us a physical death. That is going to be completely removed and we're going to be given new bodies. I'll be interested to see how my knees hold up to my running then. There'll be no night. That's talked about in Revelation 22:5. And more importantly, no death. There is only life in the presence of God and his Son. That is the only thing there is. There once was a young minister who got on a streetcar one day, and he had his Bible tucked under his arm. And as he got on, a young group of men started chastising him and giving kind of a brazen, going, oh, look at that preacher guy, and just making snide comments and remarks to him. Well, the young minister kept his mouth shut and just rode the car. And then at his stop, he stopped and stepped off the car. And one of the young men said to him, says, how far is heaven away from here? And the young minister said, one step. Will you take it today? That's where I'm going to end it today. This heaven that we've talked about for the past 30 minutes, it's only one step away. You being able to see the beauty that John is trying to describe is only one step away. Will you make it today? And if you have made it already, I ask that you keep taking that step each day by day, each moment by moment. Let's look forward to what's to come. Let's pray. Father, thank you for letting us in, just opening the door just a little bit so we can see the glimpse of what's about to come. You are a beautiful and amazing God, one that John's words here can't even describe, Lord, and we know they're unfathomable. Hey, they're just beautiful. Lord, thank you for showing us a glimpse into the kingdom to come. Lord, but be with us. We're either in one of two boats, Lord, here today. We've already made that decision to serve you, and we're anticipating the day when our citizenship card can be stamped and we can be dwelling with you, and more importantly, you dwelling amongst us face to face. Lord, but if you haven't made that step today, if someone here who isn't, Lord, I ask that they will choose to serve you today, to call upon the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, and accept them as their Lord and Savior. And if they haven't, Lord, I ask that they seek someone today, either me or Tony or one of the other elders here, Lord, that they will get to know you so that you can dwell with them for eternity to come and that they don't have to live in a lake of fire. It's in your Son's name we pray, Jesus Christ. Amen.